So thanks everyone for joining and the thumbs up. My name is Lorne and I'm the volunteer and education coordinator with the Green Mountain Club. Really excited to have Matt and Molly and Sarah joining us tonight for a program titled Telling Vermont's Story, Climate, Forest, and Community. I'll give my quick rundown of how we got to where we are and let them say their story as well. But Matt and Molly and Sarah reached out to the GNC asking about opportunities for service learning or other projects on the Long Trail as a part of one of their UVM classes. We got to talking and thinking about how there's not really much public education about the GNC's role in Vermont's forests and in the community and the communities that it serves and the effects of climate change that will inevitably be felt on the Long Trail system and outdoor recreation. And so they went to work creating a program and we're now here this afternoon. So thanks for joining for that and really excited to hear what they put together, see some of the product and learn a lot about this trail that I supposedly work for and know. So thanks again to Matt and Molly and Sarah. The Green Mountain Club, for those of you that don't know, is the organization that takes care of Vermont's Long Trail. The trail runs from the Massachusetts border to the Canadian border and is 272 miles long. Green Mountain Club also takes care of about 166 miles of side trail, the 50 miles of the AT in Vermont, and about 50 miles of hiking trails in the Northeast Kingdom. The club manages over 25,000 acres of conserved land. And as of this year, there's only about 5.5 miles of the Long Trail that remains unprotected. The rest of the trail has either found its way onto national forest or onto protected state land or through a GMC-held easement. So it's a really special thing, and it's a good place to be. The Long Trail welcomes over 200,000 visitors every year. There's a crew of 40 seasonal staff that work to maintain it, and over 1,000 annual volunteers that really are the backbone of the organization and the trail. As I mentioned, seasonal staff, that includes our caretakers and trail crew. The top photo may look a little bit older than the bottom photo, although I guess not really. The caretakers are stationed on busy summits and fragile ponds, and they do hiker education, they compost human waste, they do trail work, and they maintain the fragile ponds and summits that are visited by lots of people every year. The trail crews live in the woods for a week at a time. They build trail, they reconstruct trail, they build shelters, renovate privies, all the things that keep the whole trail going and make improvements year after year. That picture on the bottom left there would be an alpine summit and the string designed to kind of give people a visual barrier to where the actual path of the trail is. We maintain shelters and privies. No privies continue to look as the top right one does there. That would be Stratton Pond back in the mid 70s. Luckily we've moved on from that. The one in the top there is Governor Clement, which was brand new this year. And then Taft Lodge and Churchill Scott Shelter. So there's over 70 overnight sites on the Long Trail designed to concentrate human use. As I said, with over 200,000 annual users and lots of hikers, if we didn't have these sites to concentrate use, we would have dispersed camping and toilets all over, which would not be a good thing for our climate, our forest, or our community. And then we do trail maintenance and conservation. I said this a little bit already, but if we didn't have people out there like our volunteers or our staff to keep the trail open and clear, the blazes would fall off the trees and trees would fall down and cross the trail and brush would grow in and mud pits would become bigger and bigger and bigger. So it takes a lot of work to keep the Long Trail open and going. And that's the purpose of the Green Mountain Club, is to welcome people to the Long Trail and make it a free and accessible resource for all people that would want to use it. So doing that on the ground is a really important job. And then maintaining open areas of conservation and land access. The Green Mountain spine is where the Long Trail sits and is largely conserved. And it's really nice how those two mesh together a lot. Green Mountain Club is a membership organization. We have just under 10,000 members. We got lots of good events coming up this season, lots of good ways to support the organization. So definitely check those out online. Matt and Molly and Sarah, I guess now I would turn over a screen share to you, and I'd love to hear a little bit about your project and let you guys get rolling. So let me stop there. get started.
Yeah, thanks, Lauren. I guess we'll just go through each of us and introduce ourselves, and then we can jump onto our screen share of our own. So hi, my name is Matt Voss. I'm a senior at UVM studying environmental studies.
Hi, I'm Molly, and I am a junior at UVM, and I'm studying environmental studies and economics.
And hi, I'm Sarah. I am a senior at the University of Vermont, and I am also an environmental studies major.
All right, hold on just 1 second. I'm sharing it here.
For all of you that have just joined in, I asked one thing in the chat box. I'm just going to intercept for a second. We'd love to know what your favorite tree is. Share that. Thanks.
All right. Can everybody see that okay?
Good for me, Matt.
All right. Sweet. So like the introduction that Lauren gave before, we reached out to him and the Green Mountain Club back in September to figure out what sort of projects we could do. And our course that we were doing this for is called Vermont Climate, Forest, and Community. So we've really utilized those three different components here to tell one story, and that would be Vermont's story. And we've utilized a story map here to go through some different images and places around the state that you guys might have visited, both just forests in general and along the Long Trail. So if you see any of those cool images, you can definitely throw something in the chat there too, being like, oh yeah, I've been here before, or anything like that. But otherwise, this is a picture that Molly took up on top of Spruce Mountain. And I'm going to turn it over her to talk about the history and the current uses of the forests and the ways that interplays into the state's economy.
Hi, guys. So when I was first doing my research, I felt that in order to kind of understand any current issues that are facing Vermont's forests, we need to first look at the backstory. So the major events that occurred in the late 1700s and up until today are important, but we need to recognize the indigenous people that occupied land all throughout Vermont. The Western Abenaki people are considered the original Vermonters. The Abenakis did alter the landscape of Vermont, but not to the extent that the Europeans did. The Abenaki people lived all along the Connecticut River, which is where that marker is placed. And they did clear some of the land for certain crops like corn and beans, squash, and tobacco. And between the 1600 and 1800s, Europeans obviously started to arrive, and they started to bring diseases over and decimated that native population. And once the Europeans kind of replaced the Western Abenaki in Vermont, and instead of using the farmlands along the Connecticut River, the Europeans went to the hillside forest. And once the Europeans kind of started to settle and claim that land, Vermont's forests started to change forever. So while Vermont's forest history consists of a lot of events, I decided to highlight the events that I found the most important and had the most impact. So to start, there was the creation of the first sawmill in Vermont that was created in Westminster, Vermont. And the sawmill is basically just a machine that saws logs into lumber. And there are no recorded photos of that specific sawmill, but I did find one of another popular one in Win Hall, Vermont. And the reason that this event is so important is that it did create a demand for wood, which required trees to be cut down all across the state. Another kind of significant turning point for these forests was the increase in demand for charcoal. Vermont's iron industry began to increase, and then which created a significantly higher demand for charcoal. And charcoal was basically used in order to burn this iron. And charcoal is obviously produced by heating wood at a very high temperature, and then just basically to get rid of all the water and other materials that are in the wood. And if the charcoal was needed back then there was obviously a significant amount of wood that was needed. So people looked towards the forest again. And in Glastonbury, a furnace there, there was about 10,000 bushels of charcoal that were burned for smelting ore in the 1820s. This picture is of the Tyson furnace in Plymouth, Vermont, which was another popular furnace. It's also important to note the large lumber industry that existed in Vermont by the late 1800s. Burlington actually grew into one of the largest lumber processing centers all across the US. It was estimated that Burlington imported over 150 million board feet of lumber annually. And this picture is of the Burlington waterfront, the lumber district. It's about taken where Battery Park is, if anyone knows the area. And then this next picture is of the current Burlington waterfront. And obviously there's some significant changes, more greenery, and it's definitely not a lumber district anymore, but that is the same view of where that picture was taken. And so as Vermont neared the 1900s, the state was nearly 80% deforested. And you can definitely see this in that photo behind the state capitol building in Montpelier. It was definitely hard to get to the tops of the mountains. So the only trees that really remained were in the higher elevations. And so this next picture is of the current state building. And this is a pretty recent photo taken in 2007. And it's obvious how deforested the state was, because now you can see the hills behind the state building. That's actually Hubbard Park, the woods back there. So definitely a huge change. And so to highlight, I kind of discussed a little bit about the lumber industry and the iron industry, but those were obviously both on the rise. And then there was also what was known as a sheep craze, which occurred after a type of sheep known as the Merino sheep were introduced to the area. And this type of sheep basically yielded large profits for farmers. And it was known for eating ground cover plants and killing a lot of shrubs and saplings. And then there was also major construction for railroads in the mid 1800s, and also an increase in the number of paper companies, which obviously increased the demand for wood. So I'm now gonna highlight a little bit of a few people that I think are pretty important for Vermont's history. One important figure was Governor Urban Wardberry. He's not really talked about that much, but I still found it kind of interesting because he started to voice some early concerns. When Governor Urban Wardberry was elected in 1894, he was first in kind of full support of most of these industries. And then after only just about 5 years had passed, his opinions began to change. And in his farewell address, he voiced his concerns and worries about the people who depended on these forests for their livelihoods, and also shared his concern for the tourism industry in Vermont. And so at the time, Vermont was obviously known for its beauty, as it still is today, and its good hunting and fishing. And that was obviously being threatened by these massive sectors. And right around this time was when some of the industries, like the lumber industry, started to kind of hit its peak. And Governor Urban Wardberry obviously wasn't the only person that voices concerns. A popular figure known as George Perkins Marsh, who's known as one of the first environmentalists, also began to voice his concerns. And he grew up in Woodstock, Vermont. And when he was little, he noticed how these landscapes were changing on Mount Tom. And he wrote about this in his popularized book, a lot of you probably know, Man in Nature. And you can see these noticeable changes. On the left photo is of, it's of Woodstock, Vermont from the view of Mount Tom. And that was taken in the early 1900s. And on the right is a current photo taken in 2020. And you can definitely see just the difference in greenery. And then another citizen that's pretty important is Joseph Battelle. Joseph Battelle was a philanthropist and a legislator from Middlebury. And he too voices concerns for these forests and wanted to see some change. And I'm sure some of you know that there's a wilderness shelter named after him on the Long Trail as well. But he helped form a committee to deal with the forestry crisis in 1882. And he also utilized his wealth to purchase Camel's Hump, Red Loaf Mountain, and tens of thousands of acres along the Green Mountains. And while Vermonters did start to see some change, there were a few instances that really snapped some people into action. In 1903, There was a pretty large forest fire that first erupted in Rutland and burned about 5,000 acres. And then following that, only a few years later, there was another fire in 1908. And this forest fire consisted of 106 individual forest fires, and that scorched about 16,000 acres in Richford, Vermont. And so we obviously in the early 1900s didn't have that much knowledge regarding forest fires, not to what we have today, but it still alarmed people all across Vermont. And so in his farewell address of 1908, Governor Fletcher Proctor at the time, the governor at the time, urged the importance of putting more effort into protecting forests. And only just a year later, Austin F. Hawes got appointed as the first Vermont's state forester. And after he was appointed, the first state forest was purchased in Plainfield, Vermont, known as the L.R. Jones State Forest. And that picture at the beginning of our slide for a project is actually in L.R. Jones State Forest. So following this, a few years later in 1916, there was the last log drive that was conducted along the Connecticut River in the town of Barnett, which is pretty cool. And that's a photo of right about then. So then I could like keep going on and on about all these events because there's so much more to talk about, but it was obviously clear that Vermont was damaged from these various industry sectors and was basically just trying to bandage like this large wound from all of these massive sectors that were affecting the forest. And so there began to be a pretty massive shift towards protecting these forests and even reforesting some areas. Between the 1940s and the 1970s, Vermont's forested land started to increase rapidly. And this photo is of Bradford, Vermont along the Connecticut River. And you can see the pretty bare hills along behind the river. And so fast forwarding to today, Vermont's forests are now 80% forested, which is the exact opposite of the 1800s and early 1900s. This 80% translates roughly to about 4.46 million acres of forest. And of that forested land, private landowners control about 80%, about 1% is owned by businesses and industries, and then the rest of that, about 19%, is owned by local, state, and federal government. And so there's some various sectors that make up these forests, which include some manufacturing-based industries and then recreational-based industries. The manufacturing-based industries include saw logs and pulpwood, fuel wood and biomass, lumber, paper, wood pellets, wood chips, firewood, Christmas trees, and maple syrup. And this is a picture of a sugar house in Fairfield, a pretty small one. And then a pretty massive example of a manufacturing business is the McNeil plant in Burlington. This photo is an aerial shot of right in Burlington. And obviously it's uses wood to create energy. And it's just very interesting to see throughout the state that there's different scales of businesses. There's pretty large scale businesses, and then a lot of the state is made up of small scale businesses as well. So it's just interesting to see that. And there are also obviously recreational based activities that make up these forests. A pretty common place to visit, pretty touristy place is Stowe, which can be seen in the photo here. Out of the two sectors of recreational and manufacturing, they contribute in total to about $3.4 billion annually to the state's economy. And of that total, recreational activities contributes about $1.9 billion annually. And it also is important to note that the forest-based recreation sector has surpassed the manufacturing sector when it comes to translating this into the economy. It's a pretty huge part of the state's income. And a main reason why those numbers are so large for the forest-based recreation sector is the amount of trail users. Obviously, just about 410,000 people from all over the U.S. and globe visit Vermont annually for recreational reasons, and I chose Mount Mansfield because it's a pretty highly trafficked area for hiking and things like that. And so a lot of people like may wonder, and when I was doing my research, I wondered too, is like how did these trail users, these numbers, and other recreation-based activities actually contribute such high revenues to the Vermont economy? And so to break it down a little bit, there's much more math involved in this, but roughly about $15 million in new sales are brought into the state as a result of trail visitors spending their money on travel expenses. And regarding tax revenues, Vermont receives annually over $2 million in tax revenues as a result of these trail users. And so it also is important to note that it's not just out-of-staters and people from other countries visiting. it's also Vermonters that participate in these activities and are a part of these numbers as well. And so I guess like this is a pretty good picture of Kettle Pond and Ground State Park. And I just think that it's when you see an image like this, it's not just trees that you see in along a hillside. There's so much more to that because Vermont was nearly deforested. And it's just interesting to see how much that's changed. And so we can obviously see deeply intertwined history when we look out to the valleys during like peak fall foliage season. Back then in Vermont, they used a method of called clear cutting because it basically gave them the most profits. And so that kind of drove the tourists away from the state. And then actually a long lasting effect of those clear cuts is part of the reason for what draws tourists to the state today, almost 200 years later. This photo was taken on Stowe Pinnacle. You can see it was taken in early, like mid-October, so it's pretty peak foliage. But when clear cuts occur, it exposes the topsoil, which makes it warmer, and then favors northern hardwoods like maples that we see that give it that color. And these hardwoods also have a lighter seeds and can produce many more than conifers. And so these maple trees covered like all of these hillsides and valleys in Vermont. And that's why it's so beautiful in the fall here. And it is evident that Vermont tourism was a huge part of the economy back in the 1800s, and it's still a huge part today. And recreational-based tourism and the deep connection to the land have always been valued, and it is why we should still care pretty deeply about it today. And so I guess I will leave you guys here with a picture of Vermonters at the Rutland Railroad stations back in 1910. The people that are featured in this photo are going on an excursion trip to visit well-run farms throughout the state. And these excursion trips were inspired actually by Theodore Roosevelt, who was just elected around the same time this photo was taken. And these Vermonters had a deep connection to the land, and their livelihoods definitely depended upon it. And this hasn't really changed much today. Vermonters still rely heavily on these forests for so many different activities. And so as time goes on, we're seeing more and more effects of climate change, not only just here, but throughout the globe. And this will affect this landscape that we see here today, which will in essence affect the connection and relationship to the land. And so if the landscape is being threatened, so are Vermonters' livelihoods. And so I will pass it on to Sarah to discuss more about the specific climate change impacts at a state level to see just how Vermont landscapes are being threatened. Thank you.
All right, so now that we have covered the history of Vermont's forests, let's take a look at what the future holds. The following section takes a deep dive into how climate change will alter Vermont's forests as temperatures rise, precipitation increases, winters become milder, and natural disturbances increase in frequency and intensity. So warming trends will have an impact on Vermont's forests as higher temperatures increase soil drying and more frequent short-term droughts in the summer and fall. Water stress reduces the defense mechanisms of trees, which makes them more susceptible to diseases and insect damage and limits water availability for tree growth. The Champlain Valley is particularly warm and dry in comparison to other parts of Vermont, which makes its ecosystems especially vulnerable to heat stress. Winter temperatures are increasing at a faster rate than summer temperatures in Vermont. As seen in the photo from Mad River Glen, the winter of 2016 was especially mild, which resulted in several ski resorts closing early. Our winters are getting shorter and warmer, and models predict that climate change will bring earlier springs, more frequent winter thaws, and a shift in the majority of winter precipitation from snow to rain. Wetter winters and episodic summer droughts place stress on some tree species, such as the sugar maple and red spruce that are already facing declines in Vermont. So Vermont's forests will see an increase in the intensity and frequency of natural disturbances. Heavy rainfall events are becoming more common in Vermont, with mountainous regions seeing the greatest increase in precipitation. Not only has precipitation increased, but storms have increased in intensity, which is a cause for concern because heavy rains and intense storms can damage forests. Winter freeze and thaw cycles create conditions for frequent ice storms, which can severely damage trees. Tree biomass has been decreasing on the summit and east slope of Mount Mansfield following the pictured ice storm of 1998 and the drought of 1999. So as climate change alters these forest conditions, we will see shifts in the ranges of forest species. By the end of the century, Vermont could be dominated by oak hickory forests and could lose its spruce fir and maple beech birch forests. Southern Vermont's spruce fir forests that reside at high elevations are one of the most vulnerable types, and models predict that they will be non-existent in Vermont within 100 years. Species distribution is already changing in Vermont at higher elevations as northern hardwood forests are being pushed to increasing elevations where they are outcompeting spruce fir forests. So one example of changes in species distribution on the Long Trail is on Camel's Hump. Vegetation surveys suggest a shift in species distribution at high elevations already occurring. So the loss of these cold-tolerant forests in Vermont will have an impact on bird species, such as the bicknell's thrush, which is a globally rare and vulnerable species. If you're lucky, you may be able to spot one on Mount Mansfield, but as we lose more of our boreal forests, it will become increasingly rare. And maybe let us know in the chat box if you've seen or heard the bicknell's thrush before. So Vermont is home to less than 275 acres of alpine tundra. Alpine plants are fragile and vulnerable to climate change. A rare alpine species found on Mount Mansfield called the pincushion plant has shown a decrease in population, which may be attributed to climate change. So Vermont's forests will be majorly impacted by the spread of forest pests as diseases and climate change progresses. Warmer temperatures will allow invasive pathogens and pest populations to grow as winters become milder and pests are able to survive and reproduce throughout the year. Instances of low water availability in the summer and fall reduce the defense mechanisms of trees, making them more susceptible to diseases and insects. As pictured, the emerald ash borer is an invasive pest that typically kills trees within 5 years. It had not been found in Vermont until 2018, when it was first detected in Orange County, and has since begun to spread throughout the state. So Vermont's forests will be challenged by the influx of invasive species as climate change progresses. Tree decline from pests, water stress, and natural disturbances will lead to openings in the forest canopy, which could allow opportunistic invasive species to colonize and outcompete native plants. As seen in the photo, common buckthorn is an opportunistic invasive plant that has colonized in high densities in the disturbed areas of Chittenden County. So an example of an invasive pest that poses an increasing threat to Vermont's forests is the hemlock lily adelgid. These are tiny insects that suck the sap from hemlock trees and can kill trees within 6 years of infestation. Climate change will allow their population to grow as warmer winter temperatures allow for year-round survival and infestation, which would lead to increased mortality of hemlock trees. This threat to the greatest forest ecosystem because hemlock trees provide important biodiversity niches and habitats in Vermont's forests. So I think it's pretty clear that climate change poses many threats to the health of Vermont's forests, but what does this mean for our communities? I'll turn this over to Matt, who'll examine the intersection between our forests and communities.
Yeah, thank you, Sarah. So after going through those different impacts, we can really analyze the different reactions that we can do as a community, talk about why the forests matter to us and how we value them as people, and then talk about some different ways that we can make the outdoors more inclusive and just more equitable in general amid calls nationally from this summer. So first thing that I'm gonna do is we're gonna talk about the ways that the Green Mountain Club have currently responded to climate change. For one, they've changed their infrastructure to make it more resilient to flooding, storms, and different erosion. They've changed their species management techniques to ensure that species are thriving and in proper placements as their distributions may change. They've also changed their funding and staffing in order to make sure that they can react quickly to disasters. And of course, they'd always appreciate some more of your help. So if you can volunteer or donate in any way to engage with these issues, I'm sure they'd appreciate it. But then in terms of reasons why we can value them as people and why we should react to climate change. I'm going to draw first from one of the Parks, Recreation, and Tourism Department professors at UVM, Pat Stokowski, as she analyzes, like, she creates a framework with four different discourses of how we value forests. So the first one is the natural forest, where we really recognize it as an ecological system of environmental science and the different relationships within that. There's also the recreational forest, which allows us to hike, kayak, go bird watching, all those different ways to move and explore throughout the forest. There's also the productive forest, as we figure out how to sustainably utilize it and use its resources towards different uses, like the ones that Molly was mentioning before. And then there's also the dependent forest of, we talk about this symbiotic relationship between humans and the forests of how we can manage it, as well as how they provide ecosystem services for us. We also can talk about the various ways that forests help us. So the most obvious one is just for our health in terms of mentally and emotionally, to the extent that they're even taken for granted. But we definitely want to enjoy them with our kids and our friends in order to realize this aesthetic beauty together and the wildlife that these forests really protect. Amongst this, like, we really recognize the different uses. So here on top of Stratton Mountain, you can see lots of different ideas with the protected forest right in the foreground. And then we have some skiing in the background, and then there's lots of different utilization with the lake down in the valley there. So it goes to show how the different economic and social situations, we expect some different competing and conflicting uses. Furthermore, forests really translate into the identity of Vermonters. Here on Bromley Mountain, like, if you're going to Google Vermont, right, you're going to see pictures of the state's forests, whether it be through our sugaring industry, the fall foliage, around the ski areas, and within the farming landscape of, like, the farms right up against the forest. Sort of that, like, patchwork idea that Vermont really has. And the identities that we form with these forests really go as far to create tension with out-of-staters, as we worry that this identity is going to be diluted or changed by these new people. But this all really translates into the feelings people have on the trail. This is shown through trail journals that people write as they do the entire through hike or just visit the long trail for a certain day. And with the community, that we create trail names for each other as we hike the trail. And even with the pandemic coming in and we had to evacuate from the trail for a couple months and then go back on and use it safely, that really goes to show the community and the values that people have towards it. Just to recognize the place and recognize one another as a community among the trail. But this discussion really prompts a couple questions in terms of, is the trail available for everyone, and what stories are being told along this trail? So we can engage in that for a minute. This study here on the right is by the Outdoor Foundation, just for outdoor participation activities in general. So this isn't specific to Vermont, it's across the entire US, and it's not specific to hiking, it's all outdoor activities. But if we look at this study, we can really notice, at least racially, how different groups of people are able to interact with the outdoors in different ways. I'm not trying to say that everybody should appreciate the long trail system in the exact same way, but if we could make some changes as a community in order to be more equitable and inclusive, we should definitely try and prompt those conversations and consider them in different ways. So first, we'll go through a few different barriers that prevent people from getting out into the long trail system. The main one that you might think of is cost. It very much takes a lot of gear in order to go hiking, whether you're doing the entire through hike or just an overnight, to have a backpack, have a tent, have your sleeping bag, have boots. And if there aren't rental services available, then this can be a lot to spend all at once to buy it all. And then when you add transportation and shelter fees and food all on top of this, sometimes that cost can be too much. Furthermore, you can look at time, and people are too busy with other jobs and you're needing to save money. And finally, information. Even though the Green Mountain Club has lots of resources on its website and within these virtual workshops, some people still don't have the access to those to really know what they would do or where they would go, even if they were interested in such an experience. There's also a few reasons why people would prefer not to participate, and some of these we as a community can't quite change, but in some ways we can suggest a change in approach. So some people just have a general lack of interest. If they're coming from a home where they don't necessarily have a very comfortable bed, then they don't want to then just spend a bunch of money to try and go and sleep out in some like wood shelter. But then there's also reasons like inexperience and nervousness from that. We really need to recognize a lack of transportation that the environmental movement in general has struggled with, of people might not see others that look like them within images online that people publish. Furthermore, there's language barriers of if signs are only in English and we have various immigrant communities that would be interested, but they don't know how to do different things, then we can try and address those. And finally, we need to be mindful of different racist acts that still occur on the trail, whether it's just small little judgments or verbal abuse even. And in that way, it really constricts the community and who feels welcome on the trail. So then in reaction to all these different barriers, we can ask what responses we can do as a community. So like we said, we can really try and show greater stories of people in color in the outdoors to improve this representation. We can have more conversations like this one about the different obstacles that we just talked about and ways that we can address it. We can provide very clear and like public events to have people that generally otherwise wouldn't go outdoors, give them the chance to do some rentals and have an organized trip to the outdoors and really experience it for the first time, as well as just more virtual workshops like this with greater awareness and spreading online. That way people can really view them and understand what that experience would be like. So I am gonna pay tribute to what the Green Mountain Club has also done with this within this area. They have improved in accessibility in the both for the blind with Braille brochures, as well as a few different listings on their website of different groups that might enjoy different hikes. They've also, they have a really cool blog post that I found online about just the original names that the Abenaki people gave to the Green Mountains. So I have a quote above there that you might wanna read. It's just about how with the Europeans coming in and resettling into Vermont, they totally just changed all the different mountain names. But if we want to pay tribute to the Abenaki people and the ways that they interacted with the mountains, then we can read that blog and consider the past and different communities that are still valuing the mountains, but in different ways. So then, yes, this is a picture that I took up at the northern border of the Long Trail. And just in general, to wrap up, we can try and embrace these different guidelines and things we've talked about to improve representation and being intentional with how we make it inclusive and accessible. Again, I encourage you all to try and donate and put your time towards both understanding climate change and social justice with the Long Trail and at large. And just in general, doing all we can to protect it and enjoyable for the entire next century. So with that, thank you, everybody. We would love to entertain any questions that you have. And thank you so much for joining us today.